In the last three videos, I explained in general terms how the first genome of an independent organism was sequenced. A genomic DNA library was created, many sequencing reads were generated, the reads were assembled into contigs, and gaps between the contigs were filled to produce the entire genome. The final step is to annotate the genome, or identify sections that are functionally important. Here I'm showing the first 4,000 bases of the Haemophilus influenzae genome, which represents a bit over 0.2% of the whole genome. There's a lot of information on the screen, but you can't really tell the significance of the information just by looking at it. I think this illustrates why annotation is so important. To use the genome information, we must have some idea where the important sequences are. The main types of sequences we'd like to find in the genome are listed. Certainly, we want to find open reading frames that encode proteins. I'll talk more about open reading frames in a moment. We want to know where are the genes encoding functional RNA, like transfer RNA or ribosomal RNA. We want to know what sequences regulate the transcription of genes for proteins or RNA. We want to know where the replication origins are, and telomeres, if the chromosomes are linear. Repeated sequences are also of interest. For this course, I want to focus on ways we can identify bacterial open reading frames, or regions that code for an expressed protein. Just about all open reading frames start with an ATG codon, and they will end with one of the three stop codons. In between will be the triplet codons that specify which amino acid should be at which position of the protein. Open reading frames will have associated regulatory elements, such as a promoter. When looking for open reading frames, it's important to recognize the number of different possible open reading frames that exist for a given piece of DNA. Here I'm showing a short piece of DNA. One possible protein translation of this section of DNA is shown above the DNA sequence. The codon CCT, for example, encodes for protein. The next codon would be AGT, which codes for serine. We can keep this possible protein translation in mind. But another possible open reading frame is obtained if we shift our codon translation one base to the right. Now we see that the codon CTA encodes for leucine, GTC encodes for valine, and so on. This is the second possible open reading frame. Likewise, a third possible open reading frame exists if we shift the translation another base to the right. So the top strand has three possible open reading frames. But we can do the same thing on the bottom strand, reading 5' to 3' from right to left in this diagram. Just as for the top strand, there are three possible open reading frames on the bottom strand. So for any region in the genome, we have to consider six possible open reading frames, any of which could encode for a protein. We know that just about all protein encoding regions start with an ATG codon. So when looking for open reading frames that result in an expressed protein, the first thing to do is look for all the ATG triplets in the genome. But not every ATG is the start codon for a protein. So for any of these possible open reading frames, we have to try to figure out whether it actually encodes a protein. I'll describe some strategies for how to do this in the next video.